Received a touch from heaven. I heard a word from God. Well, why you want me to get another touch tonight? Because, honey, that touch was good for this morning. That was a now. Because remember, faith is now faith. It's not a tomorrow faith, and it's not a yesterday faith. It's a now faith is, and that, and it's a, I like that, it's a right now. It's not a now as in at the end of this service. It's a right now faith. Right? And a right now faith will result in a right now belief. And a right now belief will end up resulting in a future right action, which will result in a future right position. And so every single opportunity we get to come into His presence, somebody said, do I have to come to church tonight? No, baby, you get to come to church tonight. You get to get in His presence tonight. Thank God for that opportunity. I needed them this morning, but I need them now more tonight than I did this morning. And tomorrow I'll need Him more than I do tonight. So come on, lift your hand with me in this house today and say, oh, I need Thee every hour. I need, oh, bless me now. Oh, bless. Where Jacob, a man who was a deceiver, that's what his name meant, deceiver, liar, thief, that's what his name meant. And suddenly God showed up on scene one night at a place called Bethel. And all night long he had a conversation with God, and finally his eyes were opened and he realized who it was that he was talking to. And he grabbed a hold of him and said, I will not let go until you bless me. I will not let go until you speak your word over my life. I will hold on to you until I get what I came here for. And that's what we're doing when we say, I need you, Lord. That's what we're saying when I say, I need you, Lord. It means, Brother Paul, I will not let go of Him until I get everything, everything. Screaming. Everything that He said. I will get everything that He said I can have. Well, what did He say I could have? He said I could have healing. He said I could have salvation. He said I could have prosperity. He said I could have peace. Beyond human comprehension. Well, I need that. I need that. So I want to ask you, if you want it, what are you willing to do to get it? I will not let go of you, God, until you touch me tonight, until you bless me. We used to call that praying through. I'll pray until the answer comes, and I'm not shutting up, God, until you give it to me. It's like the little widow woman who went to the home of the unjust judge and knocked down that door and said, I'm not and stop knocking until you open the door and give me what I came for. Oh, I need you. Oh, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour, every hour, I need you. Oh, bless me now. Oh, bless me now, my Savior. I come to. Oh, just sing it one more time. Lift your voice and sing.
I need you. Oh, I need thee. Every hour I need thee.
Oh, bless me now.
Oh, bless me now, my Savior. I come to thee.
Oh, bless me now.
Oh, bless me now, my Savior. I come to thee.
Oh, bless me now.
Oh, bless me now, my Savior. I come to thee.
Oh, bless him today. Oh, bless him today. Oh, bless him today. Lift up a shout of praise in the house of God. Oh, bless him today. Hallelujah. 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 Shout to God with a voice of triumph. Hallelujah. Yes. 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 Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Well, come on, let's go to the Lord in prayer this evening, and let's believe him tonight to touch, to minister, and to break down some walls in this room and everywhere that this service will be broadcast, either right now or in the future. In the name of Jesus, we speak to the principalities and the powers and the rulers of wickedness of darkness in high places. We serve you. Notice that today that Jesus is King in this house, that the glory of God rains down in the midst of the people of God. Today we declare that the Holy Spirit has freedom and liberty among his people to break down walls of bondage, religious tradition, dogma that has been taught, error that has been brought. In Jesus' name, we break it today, now, in Jesus' name. And Father, we declare in this house today liberty to captives everywhere, in Jesus' mighty name. Now, Holy Ghost, take your liberty in this house and do as you desire, we pray, in Jesus' name. And all of God's people said,
amen.
I said all of God's people said,
amen.
All of God's people said,
amen.
Let's worship the Lord.
Forever free, the Lamb has overcome.
He is ever on our side. See the mighty King of glory sling the gates of heaven wide. Let the darkness tremble. Hear the lion roar. The Lamb is overcome. The Lamb is overcome. The Lamb is overcome. And we are free. Forever free.
The Lamb is overcome.
The Lamb is overcome. The Lamb is overcome. And we are free.
That I can't control. I want
I want more of you. Set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain, that I can't control. I want more of you, God. I want more of you, God. I want more. I want
Him that we want more,
yes,
of
Jesus.
Him. That requires sometimes an emptying,
yes,
of us.
Jesus.
Paul said, I must decrease so that he may increase.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Sometimes it takes us moving out of the way and letting him just simply having his way. I know that for some of us, I know for some of us that can be a little, you know, trying, because we have to sit and we have to let him get in the driver's seat and we have to let him do exactly what he wants to do. It may not be what we had in our agenda. It may not have been in our list, but guess what? If he's Lord of your life, that means guess what he is? Boss.
Yes. Yes.
And when he's boss, he has the final say.
All right. All right.
It doesn't matter what your sickness is, he has the final say. So when you say tonight that I want more of you, that means you're telling him I want more of you in my situation. I want more of you in my healing. I want more of you as Lord and King over my sickness, over what's going on at home, over what's going on at my job. I want more of you right there, right here, right now. Amen. I want us to sing that one more time, and you know what? Just let that push out for you tonight. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, there's no other place, Lord. There's no place I would rather be. There's no place I
would rather be. There's no place I would rather be than hearing your love, hearing your love. There's no place I would rather be. There's no place I would rather be. There's no place I would rather be than hearing your love, hearing your love. Set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain, that I can't control. I want more of you, God. I want more of you, God. Set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain, that I can't control. I want more of you, God. I want more of you.
I long to look on the face of the one that I love. Long to stay in your presence, it's where I belong. I long to look on the face of the one that I love. Long to stay in your presence, it's where I belong. Show me your glory. Glory, show me your glory, show me your glory, show me your glory.
Oh, just the voices with our hands and voices lifted.
Show me your glory. Show me your glory. Show me your glory. Show me your glory. Show me. Show me your glory.
Oh, Jesus, His glory, His glory. There's no place I'd rather be. The sons of Korah wrote, I'd rather be a gatekeeper in a house of my God than to dwell in the tents of the wicked. Oh, Jesus, if you knew half the story of Korah and the great rebellion that they had trying to usurp the right authority, and then they got handed the job of being the doorman, and they said, I'd rather be a doorman in God's house. And then we begin to find out what one of their jobs was. And every year when the high priest would go behind the curtain to sprinkle the blood of the Lamb upon the altar, it was one of those Korahites, one of those simple little doorkeepers that would go, that would touch the mighty curtain and would pull it back so the priest could enter. I'd rather be a veil mover in the house of my God than to dwell among the tents of the wicked. Oh, better is one day in your house than 10,000 elsewhere. Oh, I could preach on that, but I gotta teach tonight. Oh, Jesus. Just one more time before we change our order and we dive into our teaching. Here in this room, and those of you who are watching online, just by faith right now, reach out your heaven, reach out your hand. Just reach it up to heaven. And don't worry about what anybody around you might think. But I simply want you to say, show me your glory, Lord. Show me your glory. Show me your glory. Show me, Lord. Show me your glory. I believe when we act in faith, He always responds. Show me your glory. I long to look on the face of the one that I love. Long to stay in your presence where I be. I long to look on the face of the one that I love. Long to stay in your presence where I belong. Show me
your glory. Show me your glory.
Lord, just sing it one last time.
Show me your glory. Show me your glory.
I'll tell you where you find his glory. You find it in the Word of God every single time. If you don't know where else to find his glory, crack your Bible open and begin to read and watch as he brings his Word to life. Amen. We're going to get ready to go right to the Word here in just a moment. Before we do, we're going to believe the Lord to touch lives today. And I believe that this message is going to be heard by many, many people. Maybe not all today, but they will hear it. And I'm believing that God, as his word goes forward, it will accomplish much. This word can go to places we'll never be allowed to get to. It can go to Pakistan. It can go into Saudi Arabia. This word can go to places that physically we'd never be allowed to go. And so believe God with us today that he will cause it to go through those Ethernet cables, through those airwaves, and however all that technology does. It may be beyond me to understand it, but it ain't beyond him. Because he's the one who gave man the wisdom to do all that stuff in the first place. While we're praying, we're going to continue to pray for Grandma Dorothy. And I can tell I got my phone down here, and I can see that they're watching there at the Williams and Birmingham house. We love you guys, and we're praying for y'all. I believe in God. Continue to pray for Brother Allen as he's recovering from this upper respiratory thing, and told me this morning that he knows what by faith he believes, but his body ain't wanting to come into agreement with that. Well, we're going to have to believe God on that front. Amen. Continue to pray for Rose and believe for healing for her body as well. And then pray for my mama, who continues just to kind of go through stuff. And we just believe in the God of more than enough. Amen. More than enough. A couple of needs have been brought up here. Got a handful. Melody is praying for wisdom and discernment for Asher. Melody's also asking for Justin to answer the call on his life, freedom from addiction. Amen. He who the Son sets free. Kendrick is asking prayer for Stephen Johnson for emotional healing, and other friend Christopher for salvation, and then for John Charles for continued healing and provision. Elder Will, come on up here, brother. Why don't you take us to the throne in prayer today? Yes. Come on and pray and believe God today. You were so lost in the presence of God. I'm sorry I had to kind of startle you there. Would you pray over these?
Most gracious God, we come now to you in the most humble way that we have, declaring and decreeing in faith, that we know that we know that we know that you are a healer. You will heal. You will touch. You will release. You will redeem all those needs, all those worries, all those bodies, those afflicted bodies, dear God. We ask that you just saturate their spirits, dear God. Saturate them and cover them in love, in grace, in mercy, in peace. Just touch every part, every portion of their lives, dear God. Whatever is not in alignment and in agreement with what you have promised them, snatch it out, dear God. Replace it with your holy divine spirit, because where the spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty from any earthly affliction, dear God. Nothing that should be there that shouldn't be there, we ask that you just remove it, dear God. We ask that you just touch them right now. We ask a special blessing over this service this evening. Let something be said by Pastor Sven that just touches our heart, that moves us into alignment and into agreement with what you would have us do, dear God. We ask that you watch over us as we enter into this week moving forward, that you just bless us, that you allow us to be the hands and feet of Jesus Christ, so that when someone sees us, they see your face, they hear your word, they hear your love, They hear your mercy, dear God. I ask that as we move throughout this week, that we just get to be the hands and feet of you, dear God. That we share your love, that we spread your love, dear God. Make this a time of worship. Make this a time of learning. Let us delve into this word as we never have before, dear God. Give us understanding so that when we speak the word, we can declare it over our own lives and break strongholds, dear God. I ask right now that you just touch this word so that it can be ministered to us by Pastor Sven. In your beloved Jesus Son's name, we ask it all. Amen.
Thank you, worship team. I'm going to be using the whiteboard tonight, so I'm going to ask if you'd be so kind and try to move to the front two rows here, and that way you'll be able to see my chicken scratch as I write it. I promise that if you usually sit on the fourth or fifth, the floor will not open up and swallow you up whole. I promise. Thank you, Jesus. I'm not afraid. We just sang that. I'm not afraid of Pastor Sven. He's not going to hurt me. I am a harmless little fuzzball, y'all. All right. Okay. Well, where'd everybody else go over here? Huh? I wrote small. All right. Well, I was going to move it to the center. Now, I'm going to encourage you tonight to take notes. If you have a pen, paper, have a Bible, definitely make sure you got your Bible, because you know I like to hear pages turning. Brother Allen, can you grab some of them Bibles out in the lobby and let's get them into the hands of people here? Because I don't want there to be any doubt on what I say tonight that it is scriptural, right? This is a teaching time. And teaching must have a basis in the Word of God, right? Now, I want to set a couple of things up as we start on our teaching. The first of them is that we believe wholly and totally that the Word of God is the infallible and inspired Word of God, right? So two things. Say infallible and inspired. Okay, we'll make sure we're all awake because I will have you do jumping jacks otherwise. Infallible and inspired. And I want to define those two terms. In Timothy, to Timothy, who was a young pastor, Paul wrote in 1 Timothy 3:16 that all Scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for teaching, for correction, for rebuke, and that the man of God might be thoroughly equipped unto all good works. It's for teaching, right? So tonight, I want to make sure that we understand first what we mean by the word inspired. Now, I've mentioned this a few times on a Sunday morning, but it bears repeating for the people who will be watching this for the first time tonight. The word inspired does not mean that it was dictated by God. Now, I have ladies who work for me in my office. And every now and then, I may feel a little lazy, Brother Paul. And I might say, Julia or Colleen, come up in here and write down what I'm going to tell you. Right? And then I'll start off with something like this. The company policy is going to be blah, 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 blah. And I'm expecting her, Rose, to write down exactly what I've said. I don't want her opinion on it. I don't care about her culture, her background, what happened to her that morning. I only want her to write down what I said right at that very moment. That is dictate. That I'm going to dictate to you what it is that I want you to say. There's a difference. We don't believe the Scripture is given by dictation. It was not dictated. It was not that holy man of old sat there one day and a voice came from heaven and said, Peter, write down the following. Moses, write down in the beginning
God created faster, Moses.
Wasn't this big booming voice, right? Now, what is inspired? I do a lot of public speaking at my job, right? So I'll get a group of managers to sit there. And I always tell them, write notes. Write down what you heard. I told you that tonight, right? You are going to be inspired by what I tell you to write down what you hear. What's interesting is after a service, have you ever spoken amongst yourselves and come to the realization, everybody heard a little different something else? That is inspiration. It does not, it means that God moves mysteriously through the mind of the individual, and they filter what they've heard. I told you a couple of weeks ago that if tonight, during the middle of worship, maybe my blood sugar would get a little low and I would, boom, fall off the platform, depending on your background, or if I tripped over the carpet, right? Depending on your background, you might write one of several things. Cheyenne might post up on the Facebook with her medical background, Pastor Sven's blood sugar got really low, and he fell off the platform. Pray for him, right? That would be what she would be inspired to write based on what she saw, filtered through the lens of her understanding. Brother Sisto, good old Pentecostal pastor that he is, he might have get woo, happy and shouting, and he might have seen it totally different, and he may post up on the book, glory to God, Pastor Sven got the Holy Ghost during the middle of the service and fell out under the power of God. That's his understanding of it, right? Still inspired. He's just filtering what he saw through his understanding. Pastor Ken over there, who likes to stir up trouble from time to time, he might put up on his Facebook, ha, 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 look what a klutz Pastor Sven was. He just fell right off the platform. And post a picture of me laying there. Bah! Every one of those is exactly correct. Right? All of them still recorded the exact same event. I fell off the platform and landed down on the floor. Blah! Right? She saw one angle of it. You saw a different angle of it. You just saw another angle of it. But the fact of the matter still is, I still fell off the platform and ended up on the floor. All of them were inspired. They all saw the same thing. They just wrote something slightly differently. It does not mean that what Ken saw is wrong from what she saw or from what she saw. I'm going to fix this down here before I do trip. Glory to God. All right, because he will post it up. Oh, yes, you do. Oh, yes, you do, brother. All right, so I want to make that very clear that we understand. And what you write is filtered through your mind and your understanding. What happened to you on the day you wrote it? Where have you been? How did you grow up? If you ever get a chance to really talk with Patrick or with Carlos or with George or Aldiro or even with me or Pastor Ken, we don't come from the same culture as you, right? I grew up in Germany. He grew up in Malaysia. George and Aldiro in Angola, Patrick, Rwanda, Carlos, Colombia. He filters it also through his own cultural understanding. The scriptures are to be understood in the same manner. We have to remember that the scripture was not written in English, hello, to 21st century Americans, by 21st century Americans. It was not written by them. It was written by an ancient culture as far back as the Iron Age, Hebraic, Near Eastern, and honey, they got a very different way of thinking of things now, much less 7,000 or 6,000 years ago, all right? So very important that we understand those things as we speak about the infallibility, the inspiration of the word. Now, infallible means without error. It is 100% correct. It is profitable for the man of God to use it for all of these wonderful things that they may be thoroughly equipped, right? Isn't that what pastors and apostles and prophets and teachers are supposed to do. They're supposed to equip the saints. Well, how do we equip you? We give you the word. And where is my Bible, by the way? It's laying somewhere here. Somebody hand me my Bible, wherever it might be. Is it back here? I need it. Oh, there's my Bible. Thank you. I'm talking to them about having their Bible, and I left it back there. This is my Bible. It says what it says. All right. So, now infallible means without error. That does not mean, here's what American Christianity has taught believers that means. What I believe the Bible says is without error. And honey, I got a news flash for you. Somebody got to be wrong. Because there are like, I don't know what, 150 kajillion different denominations. Just within the Baptists, they can't agree among themselves. You got the Missionary Baptist, the Southern Baptist, the American Baptist, the Hard Shell Baptist, the Primitive Baptist, the Free Will Baptist, the Calvinist Baptist, the Full Gospel. Somebody got to be wrong. Right? The Pentecostals got the oneness, they got the assemblies, they got the fire baptized, they got the sanctified, they got the fire breathing, they got the ones that handle the snakes. I'm sure they're wrong. Right? So understand that the scriptures are fully infallible, but your understanding of it is not, because your mind is very fallible. Right? Your mind and your heart is desperately wicked above all things. So we got to understand that if we get to a point where something doesn't make sense any longer, we come to a new revelation of the truth, we got to go back, filter it against what we know from the Word, and if there's some disagreement somewhere between the new thing we learn and the old thing we learn, the disconnect is not with the book, the disconnect is with you. So today, I hope to try to fix some of the disconnect that has been put out there by the church. Well-intentioned people, lovely people who mean no harm, right? I want to set that from the get-go too. The people of God, and they are your brothers and your sisters who sit in evangelical churches today, desire nothing but the best. They have a heart and a passion and a zeal for God that I wish I could duplicate and that I could absolutely emulate in every single one of us. Doesn't mean I want all of their stuff, but I want that. I want that. So when someone comes to you out of concern, especially to our friends who are GLBT, and walks up to them and says, "The Bible says, da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da," realize they do it probably not so much out of a desire to judge or condemn you as much out of a desire to save you, because they're concerned for your soul. Thank God for that people, that they have that kind of passion. It changes the way that you will look and that you will view them. They're not desiring necessarily to want to take all your rights away. They're not trying to hurt you. As a matter of fact, they think that they are doing good. Filter it through that, right? Lastly, before we really dive into our teaching, what we're going to teach you tonight is not, remember, the Word of God is not used as a weapon against others. Hear me now. We've had verses beaten upside our head plenty of times. We have seen the Bible used as a reference manual, like a Wikipedia, that we can throw facts out at people, that we can try to use to defend our position, and that is not what we are interested in doing. The Bible is not a weapon to be used against others. It is a weapon to be used against your own sin, right? Now, the Word does say, always be ready to give an account for the hope that lies in you. That's 1 Peter chapter 3 says that. So, therefore, if someone asks you and they're genuinely interested in dialogue, share with them your understanding of the Scripture. It also says, do not cast your pearl before the swine, nor give that which is holy unto dogs. No, I'm not calling those people holy, unholy pigs and dogs, but I am telling you to not sit there and throw that which is holy to somebody who is not willing to listen to it and receive it. Right? They may not... The goal of your conversation may not be for you to get them to agree, just to understand your viewpoint. That's it. The Holy Spirit is the one who convinces men of all truth. You are not Holy Spirit Junior. What you are being taught is not intended for you to try to convince anybody of anything, right? The Holy Spirit has to be the one to do that. You're just the vessel that will speak the word. If they agree with it, great. If they don't, great. Guess what you keep doing? Loving and serving and honoring them. That's it. Make sure that we make that the hallmark of how we conduct ourselves. We don't want to be people who bash people with the word, just with our interpretation of it. Because remember, our interpretation is not what's infallible. We all have the same desire to love and to honor this book and to order our steps by it. Amen? Can we all agree on those basic term principles today? All right, well, let's pray. Father, now as we turn to your word and as we take this time to teach, I pray that Holy Spirit, you would just move in this room. And Father, I pray for clarity today. Help me deliver these things and these points, Father God, with the utmost of clarity, that there would be no confusion in the house of God or among his people. And we ask these things in Jesus' mighty name. And all of God's people said, amen. All right, so here is the common narrative. We're going to look tonight and we're going to reconcile the Old Testament. How many of you have had people walk up to you when you said that you're a Christian and that you believe in that GLBT people can be Christians, and have they kind of looked to you and go, huh? Say, what? I remember the first time I saw an ad for Community Gospel Church. At the time, it had on its website, that's how I found the church, I had decided, okay, well, I am who I am. That's not going to change. The Lord had given me that revelation, thank God, right? And I remember I attended over at Resurrection one morning, and it was a wonderful time. It was great, and the Word of God spoke, but it wasn't quite my style of worship because I'm a little loud, or I can be. Not as loud as some of you, but I'm loud. Right? And that's okay. If you're louder than me, I love that. That's good. You bring some balance to the house of God. So then I saw the pastor afterwards, Brother Dwayne. Dwayne was the pastor at that time. Dwayne Johnson, I think. Was that his name? He had the beard, right? And I met him after the service, and I shared with him my background, and we hit it off right away because he had been a Nazarene children's pastor before he had, obviously, that whole thing didn't work out very well, for, you know. And that's holiness right there, Nazarene, right? And so they gave him the left foot of fellowship, and out he went, and then he got in the MCC and pastored Resurrection for quite some time. I think he's up in Washington, D.C. now. And he looked at me, he says, Assemblies of God, huh? He said, this quite isn't your cup of tea, is it? I said, oh, brother, no, it's lovely, and God spoke through it today to me, and I received ministry, but this is, he goes, well, we have a sister church. We have a church down, it meets down in Midtown. It's called Maranatha. At the time, Maranatha was still an MCC congregation. You should go check them out next week. And so I did. And so I pulled up to this odd building that you had to walk down the 50-mile-long hallway all the way. And I heard the music all the way down. I was like, oh, yeah, this is my time. This is good. This is really, really good. I mean, it was good. I walk in the door, and the lights were dimmed, and I couldn't see around. I don't know if you was there yet or not. I thought, oh, this is good, and the music was so good, and the worship. Man, I just lifted my hands, and I let it rip. You couldn't hardly see. It was kind of when we first moved in here, and we barely had all of these lights up, so I couldn't see. And then worship finished, and the lights came up, and I looked around, and I was the only dude in the whole place. I can just tell you the testosterone levels in that room were skyrocketing off the chart with all these very butch ladies there. I will never forget one of them turning around. I think it was Janet's partner turned around, shook my hand. Oh, my goodness, how wonderful. And you got such a beautiful voice. Are you looking for a church home? Yes. Well, you know, we got a lot. Now, notice there's no ring. We got a great singles ministry. I remember her saying, like, Yeah, about that. That's not good. You know, right? Amen, ouch, oh me. And so I went home that evening, and yes, they even had the internet back then, Cheyenne. They already had it. That's right, it was, you've got mail. And so I looked at this other third website, and they billed themselves as, Brother Sisto, the Pentecostals of Montrose. I was like, this I gotta see. Because there is no, well, I got convinced real fast, Brother Sister Beard, right? I got convinced God plugged me up. But you're going to get that from people. What? Because here is the first thing. What's the first story they're going to throw at you? Sodom and Gomorrah. Let me tell you, the story of Sodom and Gomorrah is 100% true. It really did happen. Archaeology has proven that it's happened. If you go to the areas where Sodom and Gomorrah was, the cities of the plain, there is a very high sulfur content in the soil there. Well, why is that? That's right, right? Also, they've also found historical proof and records that were written down not long after the time that record an asteroid that struck that area, just coincidentally, right about the time that the story took place. And it wiped out an area of several hundred kilometers in size, just about the size of the cities of the plain. Isn't that interesting? Not coincidence. Here is the common narrative, and we're going to go through all four of the common narrative points. Common narrative point number one, Sodom and Gomorrah were godless, opulent places full of the, everybody say with me, quote unquote, homosexual lifestyle, whatever that might be. I have yet to figure out what that lifestyle is. Now, I will say there is a lifestyle out there that we shouldn't be living, going out living in the clubs and sleeping around with everybody, getting up on the grinder, on the Tinder, on the Jacked, on the Craigslist, whatever else, you name it. Stay away from that. I'll meddle on that. This is teaching, not preaching. It's good teaching, right? All right? You're going to find a lot of Ishmaels up on there. If you end up going to the devil's house to find your future husband or wife, don't come crying to me when you end up with the devil as your father-in-law. All right? Just saying, all right? All right. I said I wouldn't preach. Your pastor has a hard time not preaching, though, okay? So, but Sodom and Gomorrah were godless, opulent places full of the homosexual lifestyle. Well, that's point one. Is that we're so far in agreement, that's the common narrative, right? The whole town with nothing but them gays. All right? Number two, all of the people in the towns were homosexual because all of the people showed up outside of Lot's house and wanted to, you know, Right? They were all that way. And not only that, they also lusted after anything that had a pulse that was of the same gender. Would that not be the understanding of the common narrative, that all of them, they saw these two men and said, hubba, 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 look at that. Ooh, fresh meat come walking through the market. Let's go. All right? Now, this is maybe a PG-13 message today. All right? Number three, all of the men, say all of the men, of the whole town surrounded Lot's house in order to have sex with his visitors. Is that not the common narrative? Is that not what we are told? All of them, every last one, from the youngest to the oldest, they all marched down to Lot's house, beating on the door, because, man, I'll tell you what, if that's true, these must have been some good-looking dudes. That's all I can say. Because I've yet to run into three homosexual men who have the same taste in men. All right, but let's move on. And number three, here is number four, that God viewed all homosexuality as an abomination. Is that also an agreed-upon narrative from the common narrative? Those four. Is that correct? Are we all in agreement? Well, let's start dismantling this piece by a little tiny piece. Genesis chapter 18. Where's my glasses? Because otherwise it's going to be a really long sermon. I'm going to have somebody on the third row hold my notes up for me so I can read them.
will work better.
You can. You can. I am going to trip over this carpet at some point if I'm not careful. Jesus, help me. All right. Let's look at Genesis chapter 18, verse 16. We're going to back up and we're going to start not at Sodom, but with what happened before Sodom. If you want to understand the story of Sodom, you don't start at chapter 19 when the angels show up. You got to find out why God sent them there in the first place, right? Because this is the whole crux of the story. All right, here we go. Genesis 18, verse 16. Then the men got up from their meal and looked out towards Sodom. Stop. Chapter 18, verse 16. The men got up from their meal and they looked out over the plain towards Sodom. As they left, Abraham went with them to send them on their way. Should I hide my plan from Abraham? The Lord asked. For Abraham will certainly become a great and mighty nation, and all the nations of the earth will be blessed through him. I have singled him out so that he will direct his sons and their families to keep the way of the Lord by doing what is right and just. Then I will do for Abraham all that I have promised. Look at verse 20. So the Lord told Abraham, I have heard a great outcry from Sodom and Gomorrah because their sin is so flagrant. It is in my face. And I've heard their outcry. I just want to ask you, does that sound like a loving, intimate thing, or does that sound more like a fist of rage and violence shaking in the hand of, in the face of God, saying, look, we don't care about you. We don't care about your ways. We don't care about your customs. We're going to do what we want to do. Does that, which one does it sound more like? The second. Now, you got to remember, there was no Genesis, there was no Exodus, there was no Leviticus, there was no Deuteronomy, there was no Numbers, no Judges, no Joshua, there was no Esther, no Ruth, there was no Nehemiah, there was not one word of the Bible had been written. But they did have tradition. They did have tradition. The tradition plays itself out in the verses that precede this. For the brevity of time, I'm not going to go back and read all of them. I'm going to encourage you to read all of chapter 18. Abraham and Sarah had visitors sometime previously. God had showed up sometime previously, probably 15 years prior. We preached about it this morning. It had made the promise that your descendants will be as many as the sand of the seashore. They will be, you're going to make a great nation. Of course, he hadn't had a son, and God tried, and Abraham, after he receives the promise, he believes it. It was counted for him for righteousness, and then he decides to go screw up and literally go screw up with Hagar, his handmaiden, and he makes an Ishmael. And God says, no, Ishmael, he's great, that's nice, that's good, but that's, you shouldn't be trying to help me. I'll make a great nation out of Ishmael, but he's not the one I promised. I've still promised you another. And they go, how in the world are you going to do this? I'm 100 years old. Well, in chapter 18, God shows up on the scene. Abraham does not recognize him as God right away, but he does follow, and this is important, the custom and the tradition of the day. This is going to be a very important phrase for you to remember. And he rolls out the red carpet for these three strangers who have just arrived, walking through the wilderness, arriving at his tent. It was customary. It was important for both the safety of the dwelling where of the settlement, and for the foreigners, for a certain tradition, because you didn't know who was who. It's not like you could just grab your cell phone and Google who this is. There was no ID card issued by the state of Texas to look at and to go plug into a computer to check and see who they are. And so the tradition said that when strangers arrived at your home, you invited them in as a way to show you had no ill intent to them, right? You meant no harm against them. You washed their feet and you gave them a meal. That was from the host side. Right? And free. Nothing, no charge for it whatsoever. On the flip side, the foreigner would accept that and would come in and would accept your, would make themselves a bit vulnerable and allow you to wash their feet, to get rid of all the gunk off your feet from walking in the wilderness, and would accept your food as a way of saying, I pose you no threat. This was very important when you're living out hundreds of miles from the nearest human civilization. And remember, these are Bedouins. Abraham and Sarah, they were Bedouins, essentially. They did exactly what they're doing in Libya and in Sudan to this very day. They lived out, and they just pitched their tent wherever it was. And so for when they saw a stranger, there wasn't somebody close by who could come and give them aid. All that Abraham and Sarah had was at stake. Well, during the course of that, they, of course, Abraham figures out, oh, this is God. Right? I will tell you, if you spend enough time with God, when he shows up on the scene, you will recognize him real fast. You might not right at the very beginning. For this very reason, by the way, in the book of Hebrews, the writer of Hebrews, who I believe was Paul, wrote, some of you, for this very reason, had angels come visit, and you were totally unaware of it, right? This was the Lord. This was what we call, and sorry, I'm going to throw some theological terms at him, Brother Chris. Is that all right? This is what we call a Christophany. It is Jesus in the Old Testament appearing on the scene. So Jesus is literally walking in to Abraham's tent. And Abraham follows the proper custom of the day, the tradition. That's all they knew. They didn't know, thou shalt have no other gods before me. They didn't know, you shouldn't have any graven images. They didn't know, there was no such thing as a Sabbath day. This was long before circumcision was a rule. I mean, you follow the idea here, right? So, let's move on. I beat that point to death. So the Lord told Abraham, I've heard a great outcry from the city of Sodom and Gomorrah because their sin is so flagrant, and I'm coming down to see if their actions are as wicked as I've heard. Actually, I believe that's just a nice way of the Lord saying, I've come down here to give them yet another chance. Just like God sent Jonah to Nineveh, right? God knew what was going on in Nineveh just as he knew what was going on in Sodom. But he was giving them one final opportunity of repentance. Isn't God gracious and kind like that? He'd already made up his mind that he's probably going to end up in their destruction. I'm going down there to see if their actions are as wicked as I've heard or not, because I want to know. The other men turned and headed towards Sodom, but the Lord remained with Abraham. And Abraham approached him and said, see, Abraham picked up on it right away. You start spending time with the Lord, you'll start knowing what his mind is and what his will is. This is good. And he says, will you sweep away both the, what? Righteous. What? How are men made righteous? Even in that time, right? The Abrahamic covenant was that if you believe God, you were counted as righteous. There were no bloods of bulls and goats to be shed. It was believing God. That's what Abraham. So Abraham says, well, what if there's, what if you find 50 people just like me who have believed you, who have trusted you, who have faith in you? Will you destroy the 50? And he said, no. If there are 50 people there who believe me, I won't do it. And of course, for the sake of time, we know that he barters with God, essentially. And our very patient God, who with one flare of his nostril could have wiped out Abraham real fast and started over and been totally in the right because he's God and we're not. He goes down through, well, what if there's 40? Nope. If there's 40, I'll spare the town. Okay, what about if there's 30? Nope, I won't destroy it for the sake of the 30. Okay, what about if there's 20? Nope, for the sake of the 20, I won't. Okay, just to be asked, just what? What about 10? Now, I'm sure Abraham's thinking, in a town as big as Sodom and Gomorrah, there must be at least 10. There's got to be. I mean, how hard can I got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Houston is saved. Houston is good. We got more than 10. We're good. And I'm sure he thought the same thing. And God said, if I find 10 righteous, I won't spare the city. As we know, there weren't even four. There weren't even five righteous in town. Right? And so, with that, Abraham seems pacified and satisfied, and he goes back into his tent, and the Lord goes on his way. Right? Now, the Lord is not the one who ends up in Sodom. The angels are. The Lord returns back to the glory. And he's watching this now, the scene unfold. So, the destruction of the city was already determined before the angels ever entered. Did you catch that? The city was doomed. It had nothing to do, not a one thing. Show me in there where Abraham makes a case and says, oh, I know, because if they were that bad, if they're all a bunch of flaming queens, I'm pretty sure word would have spread really fast to all the people around. First of all, what was Lot doing there if it was a city full of a bunch of flaming queens? I just want to point that out. Could not have possibly been because you had Lot there. All right? So, but if it was, don't you think Abraham would have just gone out there, marched to Jesus and said, get rid of them. That's an abomination. Get rid of them all. We know what they're like. We know what they do. That lifestyle is an abomination before you. Get rid of them. That's not what he did. He pleaded for them. He pleaded for them. Let me just tell you, by the way, even if you think somebody is all wrong, plead for their lives. Be their advocate. Never, never be their enemy. I love this about Abraham. The righteousness is a result of faith, which is evidenced by our deeds, right? Isn't that what we learned this morning? Right? It's count our belief makes us righteous. Our righteousness is then evidenced by our good deeds, because faith that has no good works is dead. And you can pour water on something dead, but it's still going to be dead, right? So the people of Sodom did not have any righteousness, therefore they had no good works. As a matter of fact, they likely had a whole bunch of, what was that? You looking at my notes? Stay out of my notes. Had a bunch of bad works. We're going to look at what them bad works are in just a little bit. All right? If there were 10 righteous people in Sodom, God would spare the cities and destroy them. Certainly not a tall order, right? The destruction of the city had nothing to do with what happened at Lot's house that evening when the angels arrived, because what happened at Lot's house simply proved what the Lord had already said, that the people were not righteous and did not believe him. All right? Pick up verse 19. That evening, the two angels came to the entrance of the city of Sodom. Lot was sitting there, and when he saw them, he stood up to meet them. Or chapter 19, sorry, verse 1. All right? Then he welcomed them and bowed with his face to the ground, and he said, my lords, come to my house and what? Wash your feet and be my guest for the night. You may then get up early in the morning and be on your way again. Do you notice something there? Lot is following the custom, what they knew. This is what they knew of God, that he expected hospitality to the stranger. By the way, these rules were instituted when the five sons of Noah got down off that ark. Each of them started a city. Brother Kendrick pointed this out earlier. You go back to Genesis, I think, 7 or 8, where the flood occurred. Afterwards, they found seven cities. Four of them are these cities, Sodom, Gomorrah. There's two others. And the fifth is Zohar. Zohar, by the way, does not get destroyed. The tradition that we have from the writings of Josephus and from other historians is in that city, they still practiced these customs. In the other four, they were inhospitable and wicked people who had disdain for anyone other than themselves, including God. All right? So, but Lot is already showing himself to be an outsider here, Cheyenne. He's already kind of the odd man out, right? Because they said, oh no, they replied, we'll just spend the night here in the city square. But Lot insisted, so at last they went with him. And Lot prepared a feast for him, complete with fresh-made bread without yeast, and they ate. But just before they retired for the night, All of the men, young and old, came from all over the city and surrounded the house. Oh, that sounds like this one right here, doesn't it? Sounds just like that. All of the men, young and old, came to the house, surrounded the house, and they shouted to Lot, "Where are the men who came to spend the night with you? Bring them out so we can have sex with them." That's what the NLT says. Well, I'm about to take this one off. First of all, what did we say? Inspired, not dictated. How many of you have read, especially when you get into 1 and 2 Samuel, 1 and 2 Kings, 1 and 2 Chronicles, and the king called for an assembly, and all of the people of Israel gathered themselves together at Jerusalem. I want to ask you, what does that mean? Does that mean that literally every single person, every inhabitant of the entire nation of Israel, they left all of their towns from Dan in the north to Beersheba in the south. They left them wide open. They emptied out their cities, left the gates open, and all marched by the millions into Jerusalem in order to have an assembly. Is that what that means? Because a literalist translation, a literalist reading of the scripture would say that has to be it, because all of Israel gathered. No, because that's stupid. Because ain't nobody going to leave all their towns open so that the Jebusites and the Perizzites and the mosquito bites and all them people could come in and take all their stuff. So we know that that's not the case. All of the men, by the way, read it through. It is principle, not necessarily exact. It basically is saying a whole bunch of them. A representative portion of the community, a very large, probably influential people from the city. It's also important to note that the word that is translated men in your Bible in the Hebrew is not male. It's people. It's people. We read a little while ago that the man of God might be thoroughly equipped to all good works. Does that mean that only men are allowed to use the Bible? Wait a minute, right? Don't get no ideas. Don't be looking at your sister and folk like that. Right? But we've heard people use the Bible that way and to say, because that says that a woman can't preach. It's not what it says. They brought it through the lens of their culture. And in their culture, a woman standing up and teaching a man wouldn't be allowed. That would be, ooh. I remember going to Germany, sitting in the house of an Assemblies of God Pentecostal missionary, and they brought out beer. And Brother Dietrich Schindler, sitting at the other end of that table, poured that beer, and while he drank him a little sip, he put it down on the table, and he's just looking at me. Little Assemblies of God boy from Pasadena, Texas. And he looks at me, and he says, "I bet you're wondering. What am I doing? Drinking this good stout Hefeweizen beer after we just got done seeing the glory of God come down in church. Ain't you wondering?" "Uh-huh." He said, "When in Rome, you do as the Romans. I will do all things and be all things to all people that by some means I may win some." There are different accepted norms within every culture. And there are different idioms that are used, phrases. There are things that I know in German that I could never translate properly into English because it would just be like, "Huh?" All of the men means that all, a great huge group representative of the whole town, gathered down around. It also says that we may know them. That Hebrew word, write this word down, is yada, Y-A-D-A. Do you know what yada means? To know. Now, it can be translated as to have sex. Out of the 98 places where the word is used in the Old Testament, only 4 times is it used to mean to have sex. This probably is not one of them, although their intent, as we will find out, was rather dumb. Here's when yada is appropriate when talking about having sex. intimacy, because you can get no closer to somebody. It is in the Hebrew culture, it's two becoming one. And how can you do that but you know somebody? This idea of promiscuity, well, that's why it's so abhorrent to them, right? Because you don't sleep with somebody you don't know. Well, welcome to 21st century America, right? We're different, right? Different culture. So let's just right now say that all of the men of the whole town did not surround Lot's house in order to have sex with his visitors. Let's just take that away. Because that does not fly with the text. You can read that in there, you can interpret that, but it would fly in the face of good biblical interpretation. Let's move on. I want you to also note who arrived in town? Angels. They're not humans, y'all. Say angels. Are y'all awake? I know I'm going long here, but stay with me. This is very important for you to understand and for you to know. Jude, turn to the book of Jude. And Lisa, would you put it up there for me in the Amplified? I think it's the second one I've got up there. We're going to start in the book of Jude. Actually, I'm going to read from the NLT first, and then I'm going to put the Amplified up. In Jude, which is only one chapter, the fourth verse, it says, I say this because some ungodly people have wormed their way into your churches, saying that God's marvelous grace allows them to live immoral lives. The condemnation of such people was recorded long ago, for they have denied our only Master and Lord Jesus Christ. So I want to remind you, though you already know these things, that Jesus first rescued the nation of Israel from Egypt, but he later destroyed those who did not remain faithful. Now look, verse 6. And I remind you of the angels who did not stay within the limits of the authority that God gave them, but left the place where they belonged, and God has kept them securely chained in prisons of darkness, waiting for the great day of judgment. So he starts talking about, look, there are these people who fell into great error. And if you don't think it can happen to you, just look at the angels. It happened to them when Satan, who was Lucifer, the angel of light, the worship leader, got to watch them worship leaders, the worship leader in heaven, right? He just said, well, there's only one thing higher than being the worshiper, that's being the pastor, so I'm going to step on up and just go ahead and do it. I'm going to be God, right? And he took a third of the angels with him. So the angels fell. So you notice he's setting a context there. Let's go on. In verse 7, and don't forget Sodom and Gomorrah. This, by the way, is the only place in the New Testament where we read of Sodom and Gomorrah in any great detail. And don't forget Sodom and Gomorrah and their neighboring towns. They were all filled with immorality and every kind of sexual perversion. These cities were destroyed by fire and serve as a warning of the eternal God's of God's judgment. If you continue going, he goes back into the angels, and he's talking about the archangel Michael and about others. But let me read that to you in the Amplified, which gives the truest translation of this passage. Look at verse 7 again in the Amplified now. And it says, just as Sodom and Gomorrah and the adjacent cities, since they, in the same way as these angels, indulged in gross immoral freedom and unnatural vice and sexual perversity, they are exhibited in plain sight as an example undergoing the punishment of everlasting fire. Well, we're getting somewhere. Let's listen now to Darby's literal translation of that passage. And I don't think you have this, so you'll have to listen. This is the same verse now translated word for word. Just as Sodom and Gomorrah and the cities around them, in like manner to these, who? The angels who fell. That's what he's talking about, right? He said, just in like manner to these, having indulged in sexual immorality and gone after other flesh. Your King James probably reads strange flesh. Now, it's important to note that they are set forth as an example undergoing the penalty of eternal fire. What is strange flesh? What is strange flesh? The word strange there is a Greek word, and it means, it is the Greek word hetero, other, different, unusual. Now, some people have said that it could mean that it is the that in Greek, that if you have two, that it's just denoting the other one of the two. It's not what we're talking about here, because what's he talking about? What was he talking about in the verses before? Angels. What's he talking about in the verses afterwards? Angels. If it had been human flesh he was talking about, he would have said homo, same, identical. But he was using the words hetero, other. Now, they proved it. They went after the angels. That is just one part of their gross immorality that they were doing. It is likely that we can read from this that they likely also indulged in bestiality. Other flesh. Unnatural. Because I can tell you, you can see a lot of things in nature. And you can see homosexuality exhibited in nature. But you cannot see a monkey trying to do a dog. Oh, I know. I'm so sorry. It's a good thing poor Kyle's not here tonight. He might. Sure. In nature, I meant, not put up to it. We don't know a lot about this detail because it doesn't say much. But we know from the language of Jude 7 that they went after other flesh. This is perhaps only one of the aspects of the fornication that was occurring in Sodom. Secondly, the common narrative is that all of the men of the whole town surrounded, we've already established that it was not possible to have been all of the men. Because if it was, I just want to ask one more obvious question. It doesn't pass the smell test. These were not little towns. Cities were all new at that point, Brother Paul. Most people just kind of lived out in little, small, little tents. These cities were starting to develop at the end of the Iron Age, going into the Bronze Age. And now, suddenly, we are to believe that these four cities, all located within a couple of hundred miles, square kilometers of each other, was filled with nothing but gay people. I just want to ask a real simple question. How? How'd that work? Or as you would say, how about that? How in the world are all these gay people going to make enough babies to keep the cities going? You might make one generation. I would just remind our evangelical brethren of what they tell us. Adam and Steve can't make no babies. Mm-hmm. All right, hello. And neither can Alexa and Eve. They don't make babies. So it's not possible that the whole town was filled with a bunch of gay people. But something did happen out there at Lot's house that night. Let's go on. It's getting good, isn't it? Now, thirdly, let's remember what the intent. Intent is important in understanding what people are up to, isn't it? Let me just see here. Were they knocking on the door saying, oh, hey, Lot, you know, we just saw those gorgeous men coming through the door. And you know, ever since Johnny left me, I've just been single. And, you know, I heard they got this really great little French bistro just opened up down the road. Can you just ask one of them to see if they'd like to come out here and like to go on a little date with me? Is that what we read there? Is this even an instance of them being on their geolocating dating app trying to see which one of them can they just kind of get busy with for that evening? Is that what it says there? No, that's not. No. What was their intent? Was their intent relationship? Was their intent intimacy? Was their intent some love? What's love got to do with it? Ain't got nothing to do with it because there was no love in the air. As a matter of fact, this was about dominance and it was about rape. And that is something that would reach up to the heavens because I don't care what society you're from. Every society will tell you that is wrong. You don't do that. Especially men raping other men in that society. This is an important point also to bring out. The entire Old Testament is totally devoid of any condemnation of female homosexuality. See, we would be told to believe that God views all homosexuality as an abomination. I would like for you to turn to me anywhere in the law. Show me where in the law, God's revealed will and plan, where God said it's all bad and it's all got to go. Go, show me. Anyone? Come on. Somebody? What? You know why you ain't turning? It ain't there. As a matter of fact, can we take another reality check? Solomon had 700 wives and 300 concubines. Mm-hmm. Even at three times, I don't know that he was a man of great wisdom and stamina. I don't know if he could pull that off. That might be a bit much. And do you think that when he got them all up there in that room together, that it was just Solomon with his three or four or five ladies that he would pick at that time, and that they was just all saying, okay, well, I'm just going to wait right here. Hello? As a matter of fact, we read a story of King David. When King David had the treasonous son Absalom, who tried to depose him off of his throne. And Absalom wants to absolutely 100% prove that he is no longer loyal to his daddy. What does he do? He sets up a tent on top of the palace, opens all the curtains up so everybody can see. The palace, by the way, was in the city of David, which was elevated from the rest of the town. Everybody could see the top of the palace. Then Absalom comes up there in his royal robes, but they didn't stay on for long, and brings all of his father's concubines, and by the way, David had about 60 of them, brought them all up there, and his wives, and he had about 15 wives. So now you got, 75 women up there with one dude? And he made an open display for them all to see. What do you think was going on up there on that roof? Mm-hmm. I don't think I need to say any more. I think we'll just let the word speak for itself. They weren't sitting there waiting for him because I'm sorry, I don't care how great of a man Absalom was, but there was no way he could have possibly gotten to all of them. Okay. Oh, poor. Thirdly, notice the intent of the crowd is rape and domination of the men in the house. Well, so let's just wipe this one off. We're going to get rid of and we're going to have to get rid of all of the people in the town who are homosexual, because we've already established that's also not possible. All right? So now we're left with Sodom and Gomorrah. We're godless, opulent places full of the homosexual lifestyle. Well, let's just dismantle that one real fast, shall we? I hear food calling us. Men in those times would rape other men as a way of showing their dominance and saying, you dare to come in here? As a matter of fact, even to this day, it happens when some armies rout another army and they take prisoners of war to demasculate the men. They will rape them. Because in Hebraic society, even in the old Near Eastern society, and you can see this in Arabic society to this day, while they despise homosexuality, it is the passive partner that they despise, not the active. Because in their mind, the active partner is still acting like a man. It's the passive partner that is considered to be unnatural. So it is not possible to state that the town was filled with a homosexual lifestyle when the custom of the day showed, or some of the things, we have evidence of the fact that they would use rape as a way of dominance. If you doubt that, there's another story that we don't have time to get into. It occurred in the town of Gibeah, which was in the tribe of Benjamin, in the book of Judges, where they where a Levite, that's a priest, that's a preacher, was arriving with his concubine. Yes, and you know what a concubine is. These were not morally upright people necessarily. He's traveling through town. He gets there late. He decides to go spend the night on the city square. Another guy comes in, sees him, an old guy, says, "Oh, no, I can't have you stay out in the city square. That wouldn't be right." You notice the pattern, right? "So please come into my house, you and your concubine." He washes their feet, fixes them a nice meal, sits them down, takes good care of them, and soon enough, here come the people. These are Israelites now. Knocking on the door, people of the tribe of Benjamin saying, "Bring out these men so we can know them. We want to know what they're up to." Well, they too had the same idea. "You're strangers, and strangers are not welcome in our town." We know that's the case because, as you go on, verse 6, "So Lot stepped outside to talk to them, shutting the door behind them. 'Please, my brothers,' he begged, 'don't do this wicked thing. Look, I have two virgin daughters. Let me bring them out to you, and you can do with them as you wish.'" First of all, if they're all homosexuals, why would he offer his daughters? Lot would know these people. He's been living among them, right? All right. So he knew that it had nothing to do with that. He says, "But please leave these men alone, for they're my guests and under the protection of my roof." "Stand back," they shouted. "This fellow came to town as an outsider, and now he's acting like our judge. We will treat you far worse than them. We'll kill you. We'll do to you what we're going to do to them, and then we're going to kill you." Why? Because Lot was an outsider. He was not from the town of Sodom. He was an outsider. And so now they're looking at him and says, "Look at this outsider. Dares to come up in here and tell us how to live and how to act and how to behave? Uh-uh. Ain't nobody got time for that. After we get done with them, we're coming for you. And by the time we get with you, there'll be none of you left." It shows their hostility to the outsiders, right? I feel like I'm taking a long time, so let me hurry and finish here. And we've already talked about the culture of the hospitality culture that was necessary. Sodom and the cities of the plain were very wealthy, and they looked on strangers with great suspicion. "This fellow came as an outsider, a foreigner, yet he wants to be our judge." The issue here was not about lust or intimacy. It was about violence and rape. And let me just tell you emphatically right here, right now, Gateway of Hope affirms all people, but it will never affirm violence and rape. So we stand in total agreement with our evangelical brethren that what happened at Sodom and Gomorrah should never happen. It is an abomination in the sight of God, and God had the right to judge those people for what they were doing. We have no disagreement with the clarity of what the Scripture is showing us and teaching us. Now, let's wrap this up. Look with me, final text, Ezekiel chapter 16. If you want to know, we believe in a phrase called sola scriptura. Do you know what that means? Scripture interprets Scripture. Sola means only the Bible. The Bible will tell us. And guess what? It tells us. You need to be on air, brother. It's not up on the screen. I need it up on the screen, please. Thank you. All right. So let's see what it says. Verse 48. "As I live, says the Lord God, Sodom, your sister, and her daughters have not done as you and your daughters have done. Behold, this was the sin of your sister Sodom." Oh, wait a minute. You mean it tells me? It's about to tell me in black and white, and he put it in pen, not pencil, so it couldn't be erased. So let's see what the Bible says the sin of Sodom was. "Behold, this was the sin of your sister Sodom. She and her daughters, the outlying cities, had arrogance, abundant food, and careless ease. But they did not help the poor and the needy. They were haughty and they committed repulsive acts before me, and therefore I removed them as I saw fit. Now, the word repulsive acts is translated in many Bibles as abomination. Ezekiel 16, 48 through 50. The word is te-ova. There are two words for abominations in the Old Testament. There is this one, which means cultural taboo. For instance, for the Hebrews, they were not allowed to go eat anything, any seafood, that did not have fins and scales. To them, God said, this is te'ova. It is an abomination. Don't do it. Well, that seems like kind of, why can't I go to the Red Lobster? I mean, that's kind of crazy. I can't plant two different types of seeds in my field at the same time. That's a cultural taboo. But why the fins and the scales? Because the people in the surrounding areas worshipped a god named Dagon. And they celebrated him by eating shrimp and oysters and lobsters and all that kind of stuff. And God says, I don't want you to be anything like them. Stay away from that. Culturally, that's forbidden for you. You can't do that. Don't go in there. Don't wear two different types of fabric at the same time, because that shows two different things being together. And I don't want different things together. You are different. I want you to be away from them. Don't plant two different crops in the same field, because I'm trying to remind you that you are to stay different and stay away from the things which are different. Te'ova. What was the other word? Zimna. And what does Zimna mean? This means hellfire, condemnation. This is what we would think of as abomination. It is literally, it is linguistically incorrect to translate both of them as the same word, because they don't mean the same thing, right? If you speak a foreign language, you'll begin to find out. For instance, in German, the word bitte means both please and thank you. But if I translated that into English and I always used bitte and say, well, it's always thank you, well, it wouldn't make any sense in the conversation, would it? And to say that te'ova is always an abomination and that zimna is always an abomination, that's not correct. This is the abomination that will result in your damnation. This one's a cultural taboo. Why? There's no prohibition in the Old Testament at all of female homosexuality. Why? Because they looked at women differently culturally. Hmm? I'm sure there is. Sorry. There's your age. All right? They looked at women differently. Men were the ones who passed on life. Women didn't have nothing to do with this. It was basically the baby oven. That's it. And so now a man acting in the state of a woman? That is te'ova. You don't do that. It's a kind of akin to what it is in America. Sometimes if you get into some circles when they find out you're gay, oh, you go do what you want to go do, but we are. What do they say? We love you, but we don't love your lifestyle. It's what it is. We will not accept that. That lifestyle is not acceptable. To them, that's what it was. Now, I want to finish up with this. This is a very important point to make.
Did you read all those accounts in the Old Testament
about divorce? Aren't there accounts, aren't there laws given in the law of Moses about divorce? Sure is. What did Jesus say about it? He says, I don't believe in divorce. I think it's abhorrent. That's what God said, right? Yeah. But because Moses, because you people convinced Moses, I tolerated some of your crazy foolishness. You could go stone a woman if you caught her having adultery. That's because of your stubbornness. Every one of them laws that sits there in the Old Testament. First of all, let's just understand something. Them laws were for the people of Israel back then. They don't apply to us today unless you are wanting to make sure that you don't wear clothing of two different fibers. Most of you are just done right there. Unless you have not gone to the Red Lobster ever. Unless you have never had pork chops, bacon. Well, I guess that's out. That's a bridge too far. If you're willing to follow all of those rules, fine. You follow those rules, but you follow every single one of them, and no person ever going to be made right by the law. We found out this morning we're made righteous by faith in Christ. We found out from chapter 3 last week that all men are made righteous by faith in Christ. All men. All men. Short men, fat men, old men, young men, skinny men. Men that are not men and women that are not women. And whatever else the case may be, all people are made right by God through faith in Jesus Christ. And that has nothing to do with your teova and your ideas of what is right and what is wrong, except that we need to look at the principle of the word and not look and try to follow everything, every last little line, jot, and tittle. Because I'll tell you right now, if you pray some of them prayers and psalms, you'll end up being the most depressed person around here. They weren't meant for that. Right? Stop taking every word so literalistically. There is no prohibition. There's no prohibition. There is not a blanket prohibition of homosexuality. The only and this is the last thing, and Pastor Ken, come on and play something, and we'll start wrapping up and getting ready to take an offering and get ready to go eat. Maybe people will now want to have shrimp, I guess, after I've talked about it so much. Red Lobster, Jesus. Oh, I felt those cheddar cheese biscuits just right now. Mm. Don't look at me like that. Sorry, you old Baptist boy. You don't know about that Pentecostal juck and jive sometimes that we get. All right? So what does the Lord require of us? Right? If we've established we're no longer under the Old Testament law, if we're no longer under that, what does God require us? I loved it. Al Dero asked a great question this morning because we talked about the law and how the law was done away. And he asked me, well, what do we do with the law now? Is the law gone? And I said, well, Jesus said, I did not come to do away with the law, but rather I fulfilled it. Well, what does that mean? It means he fulfilled every obligation that the law required. He bore all of the penalties that the law required. He did that all. He did that all. Hear me now. He's covered it all. Every demand the law made of you, signed, sealed, and delivered. Every curse that was in the law, signed, sealed, and delivered in Jesus. Stay with me now. Every blessing the law gave for obedience, signed, sealed, and delivered, and it's all found in Jesus. He fulfilled it all. Therefore, you are under no longer an obligation to keep the law to earn God's favor or to have his merit. None whatsoever. That was wiped away with the blood of Jesus. Well, does that mean now that we can just sin all the more? Because now we're under grace? It's because we're grace, God's going to be made greater. And Paul says, no, God forbid. He looks and he says, in the book of Romans, as he wraps up Romans, he says, no, O people of God. The Lord has already, Micah 6:8 says, no, O people of God, the Lord has told you what is good and what he requires of you to do what is right. He said to love mercy, to walk humbly with our God. And then he says, let love, in Romans 13, let love be your only debt. If you love others, you have done all that the law demands of you. Doesn't that change the whole story of Sodom? Were they showing any love to all them people out to these angels? There was no love in that whatsoever. There was no love. It was violence. It's rape. But he says, let love be your only debt. If you love others, you do all that the law demands. In the law, there are many commandments, such as be faithful in marriage, do not murder, do not steal, do not want what belongs to others. But all of these are summed up in the commandment that says, love others as much as you love yourself, and no one who loves others will harm them. So love is all that the law demands. So I want to set the people of God at some liberty today. We are not about to start letting people put you back under the thumb of this rule and that rule and this rule. Paul wrote in Romans 4, we studied it this morning, that the only way that you can be guiltless under law is for there to be no law. Because the moment that somebody writes a law, you will break it. You don't believe me? Look at the speed limit out yonder. Right? Speed limit out on I-10 is 70 miles an hour, 65 miles an hour. Tell me who actually drives 65. Nobody. We all drive faster. But if there was no law saying you can't drive over 65, nobody would be guilty of it. Isn't that right? Jesus fulfilled the rule. Can I just set you at liberty today? Stop trying to follow the rules and start making the pursuit of Jesus the focal point of your life. Your identity should not be anything other than Jesus follower. Whatever other thing you want to tag on after that, you knock yourself out. You throw any letter in the alphabet soup on there and say, I'm this, I'm that. Honey, forget all that. I follow Jesus. I follow Jesus first. He's my Alpha and He's my Omega. He's my beginning and my end. My identity is not a G, a L, a B, a T, a B, C, a D, a A, D, D, H, T, A, B, C, D, H. It's none of those things. It's not TBN.com. It's Jesus, J-E-S-U-S. I am righteous by the blood of Jesus Christ, and nothing that any man can ever say can change that. Why? I believed God, and it was counted to me as righteousness. My righteousness will produce the right kind of belief. Righteousness which comes by faith will produce the right belief. And remember what we said, Psalm 1:1, right thinking results in right behavior, which results in right position. Thinking, behavior, position. You're going to keep hearing that from your pastor over and over and over again in 2017. I'm not trying to change your behavior. I'm not trying to change your identity in one way or another. I'm trying to change your thinking. Let this be the very first thing you think about in the morning and the last thing you think about at night. You think on this word, you meditate on this word, you get this word rooted and grounded and established and deep in you. I promise you, you will become like mighty oaks of righteousness. I am looking for the day. I don't care what letter of the alphabet you want to say you are. Let's just be about Jesus and His Word. And I promise you, the city of Houston will never, ever be the same. And suddenly, those people which were not a people will have become the people of God. And the people who said that God was not theirs, He'll look at them and say, I am their God. Oh, church, hear me today. The Jews weren't that special. They was just another group of people, a bunch of Bedouins wandering out in the wilderness. And God said, I'll make a people out of those who were not, and I will be their God, and they will be my people. People may look at you and say, you ain't nothing, and you'll never amount to nothing, and that Gateway of Hope, well, I heard it was that kind of church. Well, let them say what they will say, but in the end, let our praise speak louder than our words. Because if He can just use me, go back to that song we started service with, whatever that was. I need you. I need you. Every hour I need you. That's what we need. I need that more than finding some substantiation. You know, I've had some gay people come run up to me and they say, show me a gay person in the Bible. I don't need to. Just like I don't need to show you a black person in the Bible or a white person in the Bible. Just like you can stop looking at that. Because that's not the focal point of this book. Whether Jonathan and David was or wasn't, to me, quite frankly, I don't care. Whether Ruth and Naomi, I don't need that to find validation. You shouldn't need to find yourself in the book to have a validation. All you need to care about is what he actually did say, not what he didn't say. And what did he say? All who call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Simple. That's not hard. Well, what's included? Brother Chris, I'm not good with my English. I come from another country. What's all mean? Oh, I'm confused. Brother Beard, I'm sorry. What's everything? The whole ball of wax. I don't know. I'm not from here. What's a whole ball of wax? Okay, but mate, what's all in Malaysia? I mean, is that different? I mean, where I come from, all is like everybody. All. Complete it. Ooh, Jesus. Red and yellow, black and white, they are precious in his sight. I hope that we have destroyed the common narrative of the book that we have been told through the years, and that you have come to the understanding that your Father is pursuing you with an everlasting love, and you can run as far as you want. Now, I realize most of the people in this room, you're probably believers, but I'm going to speak to people who will see this video online, who will watch this video even right now. You can run from God. You can listen to what they have said, and you can say, oh, they said I was an abomination and that God can't love me. But God said in Romans 8, I am persuaded that neither height nor depth nor angels nor principalities nor things present nor things to come nor any other creature, including yourself, can separate you from the love of God that is in Jesus. Well, what does that mean? God demonstrates his love to us in this. While I was a sinner, Christ died for me. And I don't care where you are. The next time somebody points that stubby finger and gets that Bible out and tries to point it at you as a weapon, remind them that that book is only to be a weapon to cut out their own sin, not to be used as a weapon against somebody else's. Know what the book says about you. Know what the book says about you. You are the righteousness of God in Jesus Christ. I appreciate you taking so being patient as we said it. I hope you learned something tonight. I hope you can look at that story a whole new way, and that you can see the love of God demonstrated to mankind. His unfailing love and patience, that even though their sin cried out to them, he showed up yet one more time to give them the chance to bow their knee and to repent. Why was Sodom destroyed? Because there were none righteous. There were none righteous. My friend, we want to see revival in the city of Houston, don't we? I already said there's more than 10 just in this room, righteous people. Let your steps be ordered of God. Come on, stand with me today. Can I have someone move this for me, please? Thank you, Jesus. Come on, lift your hands with me today and say, I need you. I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour. Oh, bless me now, my Savior. I come to thee. Oh, come on, don't you let good. Oh, God, until you have had a touch. I need you. Oh, I need you every hour. Every hour I need you. Oh, bless me now, my Savior. I come to. Oh, bless me now, my Savior. Oh, bless me now, my Savior. I come to. Would you bow your head and close your eyes in this room this evening? I'm going to ask those of you who are watching online right now, you do the same where you are. Is your heart right with God? God is looking for righteous people. And righteousness is not caused by what we do. It is caused by believing God and His Word. What did God say? If you will call upon the name of the Lord, you will be saved. If today you're in this room or you're watching online and you need to make right your relationship with God, just where you are, would you lift your hand where you are right now? Anybody in this room? Then we're going to pray for those who are watching online. My friend, if you will simply pray this simple prayer and believe in your heart what God has said, His Word promises you that you will be saved. Could I ask you in this room, would you pray this prayer with me today? Lord Jesus, I know I'm a sinner, separated from you by my sin. I ask you, Lord, now to come into my heart and to cleanse me. I agree with you and what you said about my sin. I'm willing to put it away and to cling only to you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen and amen. You prayed that prayer. You send us an email right now. You just send me an email so I can touch base with you. HoustonGatewayOfHope@gmail.com. And I promise you, we will pray with you. We'll connect you with a Spirit-filled, Jesus-centered, Bible-based, open and affirming church in your area where you can grow and flourish. And in this room, just as we conclude today, would you just one more time, we're going to sing that I need you one more time as we conclude. In a moment, I'm going to ask you if you have tithes or offerings to bring. I always encourage you, never come to the house of God without bringing something to bring Him. And so we're going to make that available to you. And actually, why don't we just pray over that right now? And if I could have, you guys can just come down to the front here and just put it in the bowls up on the table. That's fine. Come on, would you sing? I need you, oh, I need you every hour, every hour I need. Bless me now, my Savior. I come to thee. Oh, I need thee. Oh, I need thee every hour. Every hour I need. Bless me now, my Savior. I come to thee. Oh, bless me now. Oh, bless me now, my Savior. I come. Yeah. My, what a time we had tonight. What a time we had. Remember, our next Sunday Night Live will be the first Sunday night of March. We will not do one first Sunday of February at Super Bowl. I think I'd be here all by myself next week. Who's playing Patriots and Falcons? Who's going to win it? Well, we'll see. All right. We'll check your prophetic right there. All right. And then, of course, Tuesday night, why is God moving at Gateway? Why is God adding to Gateway? Why is God prospering Gateway? Why is Gateway thriving? Because Gateway is a house of prayer. Tuesday night, 7:30, be in the living room. I will tell you, you have never been to a prayer meeting quite like the ones at Gateway. We love to pray, and we declare the promises of God's Word. We're doing it over your lives. Well, you might as well come join. I'm looking for the day that prayer meeting's the biggest service of the week. Yes. I'm believing for that day, and it's getting there. I'll tell you, get some good teaching, too. Good teaching, great time of prayer. You'll leave up here ready to run through a troop and leap over a wall in Jesus' name. So that's that. Sunday morning, 10 o'clock Sunday school, 11 o'clock service. Let's pack the house out as we look at another one of my favorite chapters, Romans 5. I can't wait. All right. Come here, brother. Come here, brother. Come here. 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 I am so grateful for this, brother. If you haven't gotten a chance to meet Brother Sisto, sweeter pastor, you will never, ever meet, including me. I'm nice, but I ain't nearly as sweet as this man. I'm going to ask if you would you dismiss our service in prayer today? Would you ask God's blessing over this people as they go, as we prepare to go? After he prays, if you'll lift your hands as we offer the benediction.
Heavenly Father, we come before thee,
Jesus.
Because we have no one else to go.
Yes, Father, in the name of Jesus.
You gave your all for us. And we give it all to you, Lord, because you gave your all for us. I want to thank you, Lord, for your love, for your mercy. Oh, hallelujah, because you have a people that really loves you, Lord, and worships you. I want to thank you, Lord, for this house of God, for this pastor who is so passionately, hallelujah, to demonstrate and to teach the word of truth. I ask you, Lord, hallelujah, to heal anyone spiritually and physically, including myself, Lord. And in every way, Father. And we ask you, Lord, we do not leave from your presence, but only from this place. Take us, Lord, and keep us, Lord, that we be remain faithful and to be an example to be and have the mind of Christ. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, we pray, Lord. Gracias, Señor, por tu Espíritu Santo esta noche. Bendice a aquellos, Señor, que no te conocen, Señor, también que vengan a los pies de la cruz, que tú lo entregaste todo por nosotros. En el nombre de Cristo Jesús, el Señor de gloria les bendiga. May the Lord and God, our Savior, bless each and one of you in Jesus' name.
So I say over you, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord smile on you and be gracious to you. The Lord is showing you his favor and giving you his peace. Our worship is not over. Our service is just beginning. Let us go be the people of God. Amen. Amen. God bless you. The altar will remain open. Take your time in the house of God.